God's inerrant word, as we find it recorded in Psalm 46, verses 3 and 4, listen for our call to worship this morning. Though its waters roar and foam, though the mountains quake at its swelling pride, there is a river whose streams make the city of God glad, the holy dwelling places of the Most High. Shall we continue to worship by turning in our hymnals to hymn number 8, standing as we sing, to the glory of God. Shall we stand and sing together?
Yeah.
God and our Heavenly Father, as we come before you, we thank you for your faithfulness. We thank you, Heavenly Father, for being with us, guiding and directing us. We thank you, Heavenly Father, for Jesus Christ, your Son. Bless us now as we worship you and our Heavenly Father. May your Holy Spirit have his will and his way. Touch each soul that's here, and may your name be lifted up. May it be praised, and may it be glorified, for we ask and pray it all in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Thank you, and please be seated. And good morning. We welcome each and every one of you into God's house this morning. We know that he's going to bless you in this hour that we worship him together. Now, I greet you in the name of a risen and a soon coming again Savior. I want you to turn to someone sitting alongside of you, in back of you, in front of you. Extend a right hand of fellowship and greet one another in the name of the Lord. Just a few announcements to share with you this morning. I call your attention always to those friendship pads that are directly in front of you in the pew there. Only takes a moment. You sign it. You pass it along. Great help in our ministry here. Our Pastor Dave and Carolyn are away celebrating their 40th wedding anniversary and their return home this week. We ask for prayer for Mercy's journeys as they return home to us, and they could return refreshed and renewed in the time that they had together. Tonight at 6:30 p.m., we have our book club ministry. The book they're studying is The Reason for God by Timothy Keller. And it's this evening at 6:30 here in the church. They invite you to come and be a part of their fellowship. And that's tonight, the book club ministry at 6:30. Immediately after church this morning at 12:15, the deacons are having a meeting for those of you who are involved. Immediately after church at 12:15, a deacon's meeting. Also at 12:15, our senior choir rehearsal for teenagers and adults. So please keep this in mind. And they ask if you want to come and join their ministry. They welcome you to come that you might be blessed and be a blessing to someone else as you sing in the choir. Prayer meeting on Wednesday evenings. They'll continue studying 1st, 2nd, and 3rd John verse by verse. Was also a free study book that's being provided. Now you've seen the sign outside, help us and paint the outside of the church, and that's what we're going to do. The Lord's facility here, it needs it done, and it needs done professionally, and we're going to have that done. And we're asking if you would like to help by giving a gift for that, just put in an envelope and mark it for painting, and it's supposed to be done by the end of this month. And after it's all done, it's certainly to look beautiful, and it's supposed to last for 30 years. So I won't be around when it's wearing out for the next time. But it's something that needed to be done. We want you to join in, help us, if you could, by giving a gift and mark your envelope for painting. Now, Operation Christmas Child is upon us. The due date is November 15th. The first thought that comes to your mind, oh, I've got plenty of time. No, you don't. It's right around the corner. So all we ask you to do is to take one of the shoe boxes that are in the vestibule as you leave, and as you do, inside each shoe box, there's a pamphlet that tells you how to pack your shoe box, what kind of gifts to give, and there's also, it's on the back here, it's for a boy or girl, different age groups. You put that on top of the box. Inside the box, there's an envelope in here. You can put your gift of $7. That helps defray the cost of shipping not only to North Carolina, but from North Carolina throughout the world. And that's $7 per box, and we appreciate that. You can make your check out to OSPC, and instead of sending 150, 100, 200 checks down to North Carolina, we'll send one check from OSPC for all that is given. It's a great, great ministry, and we want you to be a part of it. Not only you, but maybe some of your friends, other churches that might not be involved in this Operation Christmas Child. We welcome them to take one of the shoe boxes, one of your friends' shoe boxes, and we got 200 of them, so we're hoping we're going to do real well. Well, I can't do it. I just can't get out of the house. Tell you what we're going to do. We have two individuals here, Pam Bradley and Carolyn Meldrum, will do your shopping for you. They will fill up the shoebox for you. Just give them $20. That includes the $7 for shipping. And they'll fill up the box. And be for a boy. You tell them what you want it for, a boy or for a girl, and what age group, and they'll take care of it. And they'll put it up here with the rest of the boxes. Somebody came up and put more boxes up here. I counted earlier this morning, 28. So I'm going to say 1, 2, 3, 4, 32. We're on our way. We have 200 of them. And like I say, as you leave, they're right outside those doors there. And we want you to take one, go crazy at the dollar store, and fill it up. And on Christmas morning, there will be a child that will receive your gift. And inside that box will be some pamphlets, Christian pamphlets, in their own native language that they will be able to share with. And it's a great, great ministry. We want you to be a part of it, so won't you please make a note of it. November the 15th is just around the corner. I have one final announcement, and it's a very, very important announcement, so that's the reason I saved it to the very end. It's not in your bulletin, but maybe you saw the sign when you came up to church about painting. We want you to pray about that, too. It should be done by the end of the month. And the other thing we definitely want you to pray about, we should be hearing from the taxpayer advocate on Wednesday with regard to the $13,000 that we are owed by the IRS. Please make this an urgent matter of prayer. We have been waiting for 3.5 years how to resolve this issue. And we'll have more detail at the quarterly meeting next week. It has something to do with the fact of statute of limitations ran out in 2 years, and we answered them with a letter 5 days before the 2 years were up. And whether or not they honor it, that's something else. But we had already paid that $13,000, and they sent us a letter that we had to pay another $13,000, which we didn't have to pay, and we've been fighting for 3.5 years. Hopefully it'll come to an end this Wednesday as we hear from the taxpayer advocate. But we're asking you to please, please make it a matter of prayer if you would. These are all the announcements I have. I'm going to ask the ushers, if they will, to come forward now as we continue to worship our living Lord by giving unto him our gifts, our tithes, and our offerings. about it. The flowers this morning, they are presented to the glory of God, and they're given in loving honor of Dom Pacetti on his birthday and Christina Pacetti on her birthday from Jean, children, and the grandchildren. And we thank you so much for beautifying our sanctuary this morning, and our congratulations to Christina and Dom on their birthdays. Shall we rise and sing a doxology together? Father, we do lift our voices in praise and in thanksgiving unto you. We know, Heavenly Father, for all gifts come from you. And we thank you, Heavenly Father, that you've included us in your ministry. We'd ask you, Heavenly Father, that your blessings be upon these gifts, these tithes, these offerings. We dedicate them unto you and to your work. And we ask you, Heavenly Father, that your blessings be upon them. Use them all in accordance with your will. For we ask and pray it all in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. We come to a very special time in our worship experience, a time when we come before the Lord in prayer. Certainly there are needs that you have, but there are needs that other people have also. Some of them are listed in your bulletin here this morning. All of these people are in need of prayer. And I call just a few to your attention: Jean Ireton, Gloria Jones, Jamie Hosford, Amy Dowg, Shirley Ebersole, Jackie Hughes, Frazier and Marie Allberger, and everyone else who is on all of our prayer lists. They have a need. We should uphold them before our Heavenly Father to meet that need that's in their lives. Our missionary for this coming week is John and Dacia Abramovich. They're with the Bible Club movement in Poland, and they work with children over there, and they do a great ministry. We help support them financially, but this week we're going to ask that you uphold them in prayer for their ministry in Poland with the children and a Bible Club movement. Now, you have things that are upon your heart that you'd like to speak with the Heavenly Father with, and I give you an opportunity to do that in silent prayer. Then I'll ask if you'll join me in prayer to close. Shall we pray together? Our God and our Heavenly Father, we come before you, the only true God. You who have made all things, you sustain all that you made, and we thank you, Heavenly Father, for the blessings which are ours. The blessings of Heavenly Father of knowing Jesus Christ as our personal Lord and Savior, knowing that we have forgiveness of our sins as we come before you. We thank you and praise you, Heavenly Father, that you hear each and every one of our prayers. Even right now, as we're all praying, you hear each one individually. And you answer each prayer according to your loving will. And we thank you and praise you for that blessing, our Heavenly Father. Continue, our Heavenly Father, to work with your people around the world. Those, our Heavenly Father, who serve you, as missionaries. We pray, Heavenly Father, for the Abramovich in Poland and their ministry to children. Bless them, our Heavenly Father. Give them physical and spiritual strength to continue their work for you. Let your name be praised, glorified, and uplifted through it all. Heavenly Father, there are many who are in need. Fellow sisters and brothers in Christ around the world who are suffering for the cause of Christ. They have a need. Some, Heavenly Father, are losing their jobs, their homes, and some even their lives because they proclaim Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. And so He is. Be with them in their time of need. Heavenly Father, we have people within this nation who are also going through suffering times. We remember those from Charleston area in South Carolina, the devastation that has come upon them, the lives that have been lost. Those, are Heavenly Father, who mourn over the loss of their loved ones. Bless and be with them. Heavenly Father, there are things which are so wrong. Lives that are being taken. Lives that you have created, yet without thinking, man has taken those lives. We would remember the people in Oregon, our Heavenly Father, and also in Arizona for the shootings and the death of innocent individuals. Once again, we uphold the loved ones, friends, relatives who are in a time of mourning and in a time of need. We'd ask your Heavenly Father that you comfort them, be with them, lead them according to your loving will. And how we pray for this nation. Our Heavenly Father, we are in need of help. It looks like we ourselves cannot govern properly, do things the way they should be done. What we need, our Heavenly Father, are those who lead us, who seek you first, that in their leadership, they will follow your will, your leading, your guiding, your direction, not for their own personal glory, Heavenly Father, but all glory and praise be unto you. This nation was founded upon Christian principles, and we have fallen so far away from those principles. We need help. Heavenly Father, we thank you that we are a church body, that we can come together, that we can lift our voices in praise and in thanksgiving unto you, and this we do this morning. We ask that your blessings be upon this ministry. Heavenly Father, from the pulpit and the classroom, may your love continue to be proclaimed. Your plan of salvation that you have outlined in your word be given to all people. May we continue to speak of the blessed hope that lies within each one of us because of Jesus Christ. And our Heavenly Father, may we give an invitation to all to come unto you in and through Jesus Christ, your Son, that your ministry might continue to grow in spirit, continue to grow in number, to continue to bring honor, praise, and glory unto you. Bless us, our Heavenly Father, throughout the remainder of this day, and we'd ask, above all, that your name be praised, glorified, and uplifted. For our Heavenly Father, we ask these prayers all in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Shall we continue to worship by turning in our hymnals to hymn number 625, standing as we sing, To the Glory of God, 625. Shall we stand and sing together?
Seated. Today's sermon, as you look at your outline, you'll notice that it involves a lot of scripture. As a matter of fact, you'll probably be hearing me reading more scripture than speaking my own words, and that's a good thing. My words could never express God's will as well as His Word does. His Word far exceeds anything that I could possibly say. But the outline was written a few weeks ago, and my sermons are never set in stone until the words come out of my mouth, so changes do happen. So I may quote some scripture that you don't see in your outline. So pay close attention, and if I do mention something that's not in the outline, feel free to write it down. This outline could be saved and used in your witnessing going forward, so I suggest that you pay attention to the scripture and make notes and write things down. We're going to be looking in John chapter 6, so turn with me, if you will, into your Bibles to John chapter 6. John chapter 6 records when Christ fed the 5,000, and also when he crossed the Sea of Galilee, when he walked on the water, and we're going to pick it up the day after that had happened. After feeding the 5,000, Jesus crossed over the Sea of Galilee to Capernaum. And the next day, the crowds were seeking for him, and they finally found him. And in verse 26 of John chapter 6, Christ scolded them and said, "You didn't come to me because of who I am, but because I fed you the bread and your bellies were filled." And then he goes on in verse 27 and told them, "Don't concern yourself with the perishable food, but the food that endures forever. That is what I have to offer. That is the reason for me being here." So let's read the scripture here together. John chapter 6, we're going to start with verse 35 and read through verse 40, the words that Christ told to the crowds. "And Jesus said to them, 'I am the bread of life. He who comes to me shall never hunger, and he who believes in me shall never thirst. But I have said to you that you have seen me and yet do not believe. All that the Father gives to me will come to me, and the one who comes to me I will by no means cast out. For I have come down from heaven not to do my own will, but the will of him who sent me. This is the will of the Father who sent me, that of all he has given me I should lose nothing, but should raise it up in the last day. And this is the will of him who sent me, that everyone who sees the Son and believes in him may have everlasting life. And I will raise him up in the last day." Let's pray together. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you and praise you for this time that we have in fellowship together to look into your word. May you send your Holy Spirit to speak to us, to open our hearts to your word. May we understand the message that's being given to us here this morning. And may we take that message and pass it around, witness to others, so that more may come to Christ and his saving grace. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Countless times when Christ was here on earth, he said, "Come." To nearly everyone he came in contact with, he invited them to come and to follow him. That invitation is still open to us and everyone else who is alive today. Even today, Christ says, "Come." The question that a lot of people have is, why? What does Christ have to offer that we need? Well, the first thing in your outline, you will see we need to come for salvation. We all need salvation. We have all sinned against God and broken his commandments, as we read in Romans 3:23. 1 John 1:10 says to everyone, "If we say that we have not sinned, we make him a liar, and his word is not in us." Everyone needs salvation from sin. The wages that we earn because of our sin is death, eternal death, Romans 6:23. Coming to Jesus is the only way to eternal life. He tells us in John 14:6, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me." Salvation through Jesus by repenting from our sin is the only way to avoid perishing. In the first verse that we read here this morning, in John 6:35, we read Jesus said, "I am the bread of life. He who comes to me shall never hunger, and he who believes in me shall never thirst." The bread that Christ was speaking about is not the food that we eat here on earth to keep our bodies alive. The bread of Christ is the food for our spirit. In Matthew 4:4, when Christ was tempted by Satan in the wilderness, he quoted Deuteronomy 8:3. Deuteronomy 8:3 is where God said to the Israelites and to Moses in talking about the manna, man doesn't live by bread only, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of the Lord. In Deuteronomy 8, God was referring to the manna, saying that manna is only earthly bread. And it is not only earthly food that we need for life, but we also need the Word of God. And what is the Word of God? We read in John 1, that Christ is the Word. There are two kinds of bread from heaven. The manna that the Israelites ate in the wilderness was bread from heaven for their bodies. But Christ says, I am the bread of life, the food for our spirit. In John 6:58, same chapter, just a little further down in the scripture, Christ tells us, this is the bread which came down from heaven, not as your fathers did eat manna and are now dead. He that eateth of this bread shall live forever. Two different kinds of bread, both from heaven. One fed temporary life and one that feeds everlasting life. Christ is the bread from heaven that feeds everlasting life. We read in John 3:15, that whosoever believeth in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. Coming to Christ is the only way to salvation. Acts 4:12, neither is there salvation in any other, for there is no other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. Secondly, we come to Christ for wisdom. There is a saying, I'm sure you've heard it, that seeing is believing. But with Christ and salvation, some can physically see but still not believe. We read that in our scripture this morning in John 6, verse 36, where it says, but I said to you that you have seen me, yet do not believe. Jesus reminded them and us of Isaiah's prophecy in Matthew 13:14, where Christ said, and in them is fulfilled the prophecy of Isaiah, which saith, by hearing ye shall hear and not understand, and by seeing ye shall see but not perceive. Let's pray that we do not fall into that category. Proverbs 17:24 reads, wisdom is before him that has understanding, but the eyes of a fool are in the ends of the earth. Wisdom based on the things in and of the earth is not true wisdom. Someone can be considered wise in man's eyes, but if his eyes are focused on the things in this earth, they are foolish. The difference is not with sight, but with faith, which brings heavenly wisdom. It is not our eyes, it's not with our eyes that we see the truth. That's what Paul was referring to in 2 Corinthians 5:7, when he said, for we walk by faith and not by sight. Faith leads us to the truth, not sight, which only shows us earthly things. Some people, as with Thomas, may only believe in the things that they can see. But what did Christ say to Thomas? We read that in John 20. John 20, verse 29, Jesus said, Thomas, because thou hast seen me, thou hast believed. Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed. You don't need to be wise in the ways that man thinks of wisdom. God's plan, our salvation, does not depend on your IQ score. God's salvation is available to everyone. God tells us in James 1, verse 5, if any of you lack wisdom, let him ask of God, that giveth to all men liberally, and abradeth not, and it shall be given him. God is not talking about earthly wisdom, but heavenly wisdom, which is only available through coming to Christ. There's a big difference between what man considers wise and the true wisdom of God. There are men on this earth that seem to be wise, but are really fools. We read in Psalm 53, verse 1, it is a fool that has said in his heart, there is no God. Human wisdom is contrary to the wisdom of God. We read in Isaiah 55, verses 8 and 9, for my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways my ways, saith the Lord. For just as the heavens are higher than the earth, so my ways are higher than your ways, and my thoughts higher than your thoughts. Our faith should never be based on human wisdom. If we base our faith on the wisdom of man, we will fail in the end. 1 Corinthians 2:5 tells us, your faith should not stand in the wisdom of men, but in the power of God. We need to ignore all the wisdom of man and simply believe. 1 Corinthians 3:18 says, let no man deceive himself. If any man among you seems to be wise in this world, let him become a fool, so that he may be wise. Thirdly, we need to come to Christ for security. There are many definitions for the word security. The security that we get from Christ is the security of knowing what's in store for us far into the future. Freedom from the doubts and the fear. This is the security we get from coming to Christ. We read in our scripture this morning in verse 37. John 6:37, all that the Father gives me will come to me, and the one who comes to me I will by no means cast out. This is a promise from Christ that everyone who comes to him is given him by the Father, and he will reject no one that comes to him. The psalmist, David, in praise, said in Psalm 23:1, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. David was secure in having the Lord as his shepherd. He wanted nothing else. Jesus Christ is our shepherd. Jesus tells us in John 10, verses 27 to 29, my sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me. And I give unto them eternal life, and they shall never perish, neither shall any man pluck them out of my hand. Now that is strength. Jesus Christ leads us and protects us as a shepherd leads and protects his flock. There is nothing in existence that is greater or more powerful than God. So, is there anything that can give us more security than knowing that we belong to God, the Son, Jesus Christ, and we reside in his hand forever? We may suffer in this world because this world is of Satan. That's how Satan was able to tempt Christ, by offering him all the kingdoms of the world in Matthew 4, verses 8 and 9. But even though we are in this world with Satan, we have the security of knowing that we are in Christ's hands and that he will keep us. We also have the security of knowing that God supplies all of our needs. He may not give us all of our wants, but he will supply our needs. Christ taught us to pray, saying, "Give us this day our daily bread," in Matthew 6:11. We also have the security of knowing that God will supply us with that daily bread, with the needs that we have day to day. We can feel secure and don't need to be overly concerned because he will supply our needs. We do not need to worry about our needs because he also tells us in Matthew 6:8, "For your Father knows what things you have need of before you even ask him." And again in Matthew 5, verses 32 to 34, he tells us, "For your heavenly Father knoweth what you have need of all these things, but seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all of these things shall be added to you." We have security in Christ that he will keep us forever, and our daily needs will be taken care of. The fourth thing that Christ supplies to us when we come for a purpose. There's an age-old question, what is the meaning of life? And that question seems to be on the mind of everyone at least once in their life. Everyone seeks a purpose. Even Christ had a purpose. He came into this world for a reason. And we read about that purpose in our scripture this morning from John 6 in verse 38. "For I have come down from heaven not to do my own will, but the will of him who sent me." Christ had a purpose, a reason for being. That purpose was to do the will of the Father. And when we become a child of God ourselves by coming to Christ, we inherit that same purpose. Just as God sent Christ into the world to do his will, Christ then sends us to do his will. Jesus said in Mark 8, verse 34, "Whosoever will come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me." Taking up our cross is our purpose for Christ. That cross or purpose or job could be almost anything. We could be called to teach, to preach, to sing, to witness, to feed the hungry, to care for the sick or the elderly. It could be to be caretakers of his church. But remember, we are all one body in Christ. Romans 12:5 reminds us of this. Romans 12:5 says, "So we, being many, are one body in Christ, and every one members of each other." We are all together one body. We have one ultimate purpose. No matter what our individual purposes may be, all of those purposes together make up one body, one purpose through Christ. Although Christ called us with many words, as he did in Matthew 4:19, where he called the disciples saying, "Follow me, and I will make you fishers of men." Now, some of us may be the net. Some of us may be the fishing pole. Some of us the reel. But we all together make up the catcher of fish. We all together serve one purpose, no matter what your individual purpose may be. The will of God is that we inherit, is everyone will be brought to salvation. God does not wish that anybody should perish. When we come to Christ, our main focus, our purpose, is to do the will of God, to bring everyone that we can to Christ and salvation. Fifth, we come to Christ for strength. In our scripture this morning, John 6, verse 39, we read, "This is the will of the Father who sent me, that all that he has given me, I should lose nothing, but should raise it up in the last day. Jesus Christ has the strength so that everything God has given him, every one that God has given him, he has the strength to keep. That includes everyone that comes to Christ. It is God's will that Christ lose none of us, and he will raise us up in the last day. That strength with which Christ has, he will also give to us. We read in Psalm 29, verse 11, the Lord will give strength unto his people. If we come to Christ, we are included in that his people. This is not necessarily physical strength. Physical strength is what man sees. The Lord will give us strength in the heavenly things, which include the strength to resist temptation and the strength to endure. We read in 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 13, there has no temptation taken you but what is common to man, but God is faithful, who will not allow you to be tempted above what you are able, but will with the temptation also make a way to escape, that you may be able to bear it. When we are of Christ, we model ourselves after him. We use Christ as our cornerstone, the very foundation on which to base our lives. And Christ tells us, gives us an example in Matthew 7, verses 24 and 25, he says, therefore, whosoever heareth these sayings of mine and doeth them, I will liken him unto a wise man, which built his house on a rock. And the rains descended, and the floods came, and the winds blew and beat upon that house. And it fell not, for it was founded upon a rock. If our foundation is on the solid rock of Christ, nothing will be able to move us. Our foundation is our strength. Sixth, we need to come for comfort. When we come to Christ, we have comfort, knowing that God's will for us is to spend eternity with him. We read in our scripture this morning in John 6, verse 40, and this is the will of him who sent me, that everyone who sees the Son and believes in him may have everlasting life, and I will raise him up in the last day. Everyone that sees and hears and believes in the word of Christ will be raised up in the last day. What more comfort can we have than in those words? We have the comfort of knowing that God's will for us is to spend eternity with him. Ever wonder what the will of God is? Well, here is God's will. God's will is that everyone come to Christ and believe on him. In 2 Peter 3, 9, we read, the Lord is not slack concerning his promise, as some men count slackness, but is long-suffering toward us, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. Peter, here, by the inspiration of God, the Holy Spirit, tells us that the reason why it's been 2,000 years and Christ has still not yet returned, he is not procrastinating. He's not slack in his promise the way that man counts slackness. He is waiting because it is his will that nobody perish. He is waiting for every last soul possible to come to Christ. And for as long as we wait here in this evil world, he promises to comfort us. 2 Corinthians 1, verses 3 and 4, we read, blessed be God, even the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of mercies, and the God of all comfort, who comforted us in our tribulation, that we may be able to comfort them which are in any trouble by the comfort wherewith we ourselves receive, we are comforted of God. We cannot share what we don't have. And to be able to share God's comfort with others, we must have his comfort ourselves. We are comforted in our trials and tribulations so that we will be able to comfort those around us. Comfort and rest are only found through salvation, wisdom, security, purpose, and strength we get when we come to Christ. Christ tells us all to come, and he will comfort us and give us rest in Matthew 11:28. Most of us labor in one way or another. And when we labor, we occasionally feel burdened down. We grow weak and sometimes weary from the activities of working, or in some case playing, and the activities around our life. We need to put things in perspective. The things of this world are not what is truly important. If our labors and the things of this world burden us down and make us feel weak, that's a sign that we are too involved in these things, and they are not important. We need to take a break. We need rest. Do you need comfort? The answer is simple. Come to Christ. In Luke 8:14, he said, in speaking about the seed being sown, he said, and that which fell among the thorns, they which when they have heard go forth and are choked with the cares and riches and pleasures of this life, and they bring no fruit to perfection. If we come to Christ and take up our cross, as Mark 8:34 said, that cross is not a burden to us. It is a joy, because Christ came not to burden us, but to give us rest. Finally, we need to come for abundant life. As we saw earlier, Christ came to us and calls us to come to him, but he wants us to come to him so that he can raise us up and give us life. In John 10:10, he said, I am come that they might have life and might have it more abundantly. Not necessarily the natural life that we are familiar with here, but life more abundant, life everlasting, life after our death. John 6:47, very verily I say unto you, he that believeth on me hath everlasting life. It should be obvious to us that Christ is not talking about our current earthly life will last forever. Just as everyone throughout history has at some point suffered death, there's no reason for us to believe that we will not, unless, of course, Christ returns before we die. God tells us in Ecclesiastes 3:1-2, to everything there is a season and a time to every purpose under heaven, a time to be born and a time to die. We cannot be ignorant of that fact, because death, once it does come, is an end to man's opportunity to make a decision about his future. We read in Hebrews 9:27, and it is appointed unto men once to die, but after this, the judgment. Death can come at any moment to any one of us. Sometimes someone might be sick and might know that they have a short time. Other times, one might not know 1 second before it happens that his life is about to end. But in either case, when death comes to us, our opportunity to make a decision of a lifetime comes to an end, because we are appointed once to die, and the only thing after that, we face the judgment. Jesus asks everyone, come unto me. Jesus has what we need. And when we answer him and come to him, we can then have salvation, wisdom, security, a purpose, strength, comfort, and abundant life. Let us pray. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you for this opportunity this morning to hear your word. May we apply your word to our life. May we understand that it is your word that matters and not the things of this world. May we proceed out of here this morning and continue to spread your word and to witness to others and to bring the world, do our part to bring the world to the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. Be with us, send your Holy Spirit to guide us and to instruct us. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Okay, turn with me, if you will, to hymn number 503. Hymn number 503, standing as we sing.
Thank you.
to him who is able to keep you from stumbling and to present you faultless before his presence with exceeding joy. To the only wise God, our Savior, be glory and majesty, dominion and power, both now and forevermore. Amen.